We're live!
Hello, 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 everybody.
Hi, everyone! What is going on? How is everybody doing? Welcome to Let's Talk Jaws Live.
We are... I do like the song. It's the father and son thingy there.
Yep. Yeah. Guess who we have on the show? Oh, my God, I'm so excited!
I know.
I was trying to remain cool when he came on. I was just like, okay, I'm not going to fangirl out. It's goofy.
Nice guy.
Yeah, he's very nice. Victor is going to freak out because he was telling me how excited he was. Ladies and gentlemen, we have none other than Gary Springer on tonight. You all know him as Andy!
Andy Nicholas.
Yeah. Okay. So I want to put him in the big spot, Michael. Remember before we were playing around with this last week?
Yeah. Okay. Put him up top. Put him in the spot of honor.
Okay. Okay. The spot of honor. And then let's see. Where was that? Where he would be going?
Right there.
Take this down. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready for him to come on?
We are too. Indeed.
Are you ready, guys? All right. Well, let's introduce him first. I didn't know Andy had such a background in entertainment business. His mom was his mom was a singer in Broadway, and she was in Broadway. And his father was a longtime publicist for so many big names in Hollywood. Lana Turner, Marilyn Monroe, Gary Cooper. Oh my God, the list goes on and on. So without further ado, we'd like to introduce to you, he's not only that, but he's an entertainment publicist and he represents film, theater, and events. This company represents independent and foreign films and festivals in the United States and abroad. And also he serves as sales, distribution, and awards consultant. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, none other than
Gary Springer.
Coming up.
Bum bum. There he is.
Hello. Hi, Jay. Hi, Michael.
Hi.
Hello, hello. How are you?
I'm great. And you?
Doing well. How are you? You're in New York now?
Well, I live outside of New York. I live up about 40 miles north, up in Westchester.
Oh, okay. Nice country.
But yes, in New York, in the rain, as you can see behind me, it's we need the rain, so that's good.
Yeah. And rain in Kansas City all day today.
Right.
Wow. I'm so happy you came on. It's so nice to meet you.
Well, it's a pleasure.
And look, he's still smiling. I love it. It's great. Oh, we got people on already.
Let's see what happens in 60 minutes.
They're so excited to talk to you, Gary. They're like all like already on already. Usually like it takes a couple of them here and there, but they are on and they're ready to go. Michael, are you seeing this?
I do.
Oh,
full house.
Hi,
standing room only tonight.
Oh, wow. Okay, there's a few people that I don't see the name, so I'm putting you on the screen and I'm hoping it shows, but hello to everybody. Hello, Rogerio. Oh my God, it's Gary. Somebody wrote Victor.
Oh, yeah. I like that. Let's go.
Another person said that they're in Westchester too, town of Lewisboro. Do you know where that is?
Yeah, it's on the other side of the county. I'm right on the Hudson River.
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hi, Donna.
Gary, right now as we begin, you have people besides America. You've got people in Canada, Brazil, England, and Australia.
I like it. You know, worldly. It's a worldly. Yes.
All right. So let's kick off with how you got into acting. Was it because of your, not your dad's connections, but through people?
Well, of course, it's nepotism. Is nepotism the best? Well, you know, I you mentioned, you know, some of my dad's clients, but you know, I grew up in it. My father was a press agent in New York. He at one point he was the head of publicity for RKO Studios, New York head for I think 20th Century Fox publicity. And then he started his own company. He was with two other guys, a guy named Arthur Jacobs and Guy McElwain. Arthur Jacobs later went on to produce things like Dr. Doolittle and Planet of the Apes.
Planet of the Apes movies, okay.
And Guy McElwain went to become one of the heads of ICM. Mm-hmm. And you know, they always kept on saying, John, come out to California. You know, come and work with us. We're going to do all these things. But he never liked L.A. that much. And so he stayed in New York and kept the PR world going. And so I grew up in that. You know, he started his own business. So I'm 66. I was born in 1954. I guess he started his own business in like 59 or 60, something like that. Mm-hmm. His first clients were, first five clients, I think, were Warren Beatty, Richard Burton, Henry Fonda, Tony Randall, and Myrna Loy were his first five. So a good group, you know.
There's so many. There's Marlena Dietrich. I mean, there's like...
Oh, well, yeah, Marlena, you know, and of course, there's the always famous story about how my babysitter was Marilyn Monroe.
He told me. wait a minute, Gary. I need to interrupt you. If you're just joining us, Gary Springer is on, and you know him as the actor in Jaws 2, and we all love Andy, and he's on today. Not only that, but he's a big-time publicist. He's been in the entertainment business for a long time. His father's John Springer, who was a publicist for so many famous actors. We're talking Gary Cooper, Marlena Dietrich, Marilyn Monroe, Yzma Dunn. What else did we say? What Gary just mentioned.
Richard Burton, Elizabeth Taylor.
Richard Burton, Liz Taylor.
Robert Preston, Myrna Loy, Sylvia Sidney.
Wow.
So Michael told me last week, he said, yeah, he's like, and guess what? Gary used to have somebody babysit him that was famous, and I'm going to let him finish the rest. So I just wanted to let the people know in. Go right ahead. I'm sorry to interrupt you. But...
Oh, you mean Miss Monroe, my babysitter, Marilyn? Yeah. Yeah, it was probably, I was like seven or eight. My parents, you know, she would actually tell my parents, go out, enjoy yourselves, you know. And I could probably truthfully say I'm the only guy on this webcast right now who's been in bed with Marilyn Monroe.
You don't know that. You don't know that about me.
No. I said probably. Yes. I said probably.
That's true.
Amazing.
She used to come over to the house, and you know, when they'd be going out, my parents would put my sisters to bed, and then I'd sit there with my father and whoever Marilyn's date was, if she had one at the time, and then they would come and they would get me, and I would get into bed. My mother was closing the curtains and stuff. Marilyn would sit on the edge of the bed and chat with me. So actually, I wasn't in bed with Marilyn. Marilyn was in bed with me.
There you go. Perfect.
And then I remember one time she took my sisters and I to Central Park. Right, we lived on 67th and Lexington, which is just a couple blocks away from the park, and there's this big rock there, and I remember she brought us and my little sister, who's 4 years younger than I am. So she Marilyn was just petrified, so she was just running all over, you know, trying to make sure she didn't fall off the rock. Yeah, I grew up in it, and I used to work with my dad and you know, in summers and weekends and in the office, so I had an idea about what publicity was all about. Mm-hmm. And I had no real desire to be an actor. I was in high school, and it was my fourth school in 3 years. And I wasn't crazy about that. It was a boarding school. It was the first time I was away at boarding school.
Oh.
And one of my friends said, look, get involved in the school play. That way there's no curfew. You can get out of curfew. We can go out afterwards and they're not looking for us. So I did. It was a play called We Bombed in New Haven. It was written by Joseph Heller, who wrote Catch 22. It was also a military anti-authority play. He had written it before Catch 22. And it went really well. It was going really well. We were doing it right before the Christmas break. And I played one of the idiots who were basically the Greek chorus of the men who had given in to the authority. So that Christmas, I stayed home back in New York, and I went out with my parents to a New Year's Eve party that David Newman and Robert Benton were hosting. They wrote Bonnie and Clyde. And Benton, of course, went on to do things like Kramer versus Kramer and other directing other movies like that. And I was talking to this man at the party, and you know, he was asking me what I'm doing, and I was telling him about school, and I just did a play, and oh, you're an actor? Well, no, I did the school play so I could get out of curfew. And then a couple of weeks later, he called up. My father called up and said, "Look, Ivan Passer would love to talk to you. You talked to him at New Year's, and yeah." So I said, "Well, sure, you can call me at the dorm master's house after 5 o'clock." So on a Sunday. So you know, he called the following Sunday and said, you know, I had a really nice time talking with you. And I'm doing a movie and there's a part in it I think you'd be perfect for. And again, I said to him, well, I'm in boarding school. I can't do it. He says, well, we're going to shoot it in the summer because Carol O'Connor and Ernest Borgnine, Carol O'Connor is in it. And he was doing All in the Family. So we were going to shoot it during O'Connor's hiatus. I said, but I'm really not an actor. He said, you'll be fine. So we wound up doing it. And also my teacher had decided that we bombed in New Haven. It was 1972. So everything was all in black. It was very kind of surrealistic. And he had, through my dad and through somebody else who worked for Heller's publisher, had gotten in touch with Heller, and they decided to remount the play in New York at the Circle in the Square Theater. And he asked me if I wanted to be in it. You know, I was the only one from the school, but he really wasn't asking me to be in it. He was asking my father to do the press for it. But, and you know, by that time he had known that I was going to do this movie. So I said, sure. So I, you know, graduated high school, and like 5 weeks later, I'm in rehearsal for the play, which was done at Circle in the Square downtown on Bleecker Street. And I again was playing one of the idiots, and we were on catwalks above the stage and above the audience, because the audience, Circle in the Square, it's three-sided. So we were on catwalks above the audience. And for the first four previews, I was totally naked, completely naked. I was 17 years old. I didn't even turn 18 yet, but I was dead. So there were three idiots, and we had pale blue body makeup by a woman named Candy Carell, who later went on to do Herod in Jesus Christ Superstar, which was all the big fancy makeup. And then she became David Letterman's makeup person for the whole time of Letterman series. But she painted us. She was known as the Blood Lady of New York. So I had a wound in my stomach. I had another one in my throat, spattered with blood going up there. And yes, for the first three performances, we were naked. I had never acted before. I'm not even 18 yet. And that was basically my introduction to the performing arts.
And you had no, like, you were like, okay, I'm naked. That was it. Like, you were like, okay.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, why not? But you know, they decided that the nudity didn't work, and they dressed us in rags. Then they just put us in tatters of what the other guys were wearing.
Yeah.
So, but we still had that. We still had the pale blue makeup, and for the first few performances, there were no showers working, and so we would go home at like 1 o'clock in the morning after notes and re-rehearsing, and you know, I had this long, long trench coat. And I would wear it with the collar up, and I'd sit on the subway at like 1 o'clock in the morning with my pale blue makeup and the blood streaking all over, going. but that wound up opening and closing in the same night.
Aww.
It was, the reviews were so bad, they just decided, you know, not even to try and run it, and they just closed. But then a couple of weeks later, I started this movie called Law and Disorder with Carol O'Connor and Ernest Borgnine. And they played auxiliary cops on the streets of New York, trying to clean up their Lower East Side neighborhood. And I was a punk. And the first time you see me, O'Connor sees his daughter with her Puerto Rican boyfriend and gets all huffy and sends her home and takes her home. And then where all the kids are hanging out down by a bodega downtown. And Borgnine is sitting there glaring after O'Connor leaves, and he's got his billy club and he's looking, and I'm smoking a joint. So he walks over to me and I swallow the joint. He goes, he walks away, and I flip it on him. And then I swallow it again. And he walks up to me with his billy club. He goes, open your mouth. Open your mouth. And I look at him. I go, fuck you. And that's all I say throughout the entire movie, about another 8 or 9 times. He arrests me. He brings me down to the precinct. The cop asks me, look, kid, we know you were smoking this stuff. Just tell us where you got it. Fuck you. And in the end, after O'Connor and Borgnine, you know, and all my scenes are pretty much together. And then, you know, O'Connor and Borgnine, you know, they lose their manhood, and then they're starting to climb back up again, you know, because their self-worth. And so Borgnine sees me in a phone booth, and he goes to O'Connor, ooh, come here, watch this. And Borgnine comes over and he says, hey, kid, how do you get to the Statue of Liberty? And I go, fuck you. And O'Connor says, what did you say to my friend? And I go, fuck you. And he punches me through the phone booth.
You're killing me already. I'm dying over here. So then I
went away to college. It wasn't until January, because I didn't start. I knew I was going to be doing the play and the movie, and so I started in January, and I got up to college, and I lasted about 12 weeks. I walked in on my first day of theater class. Somebody said, "Oh, it's the New York fucking actor." And it was like, what? I'm naked for a show that closed in one night. And I said, fuck you. But so I wound up, after 12 weeks, I wound up coming back home and doing an internship in the city to get credit. And then I decided I wasn't going to go back there, and I was going to stay in New York and probably go to Hunter, which was right across the street from my house. And they had a good theater department. And I figured, you know, I would work with my dad and work in his office. So I went back to New York, and that May they had the cast and crew screening of Law and Disorder. And the casting directors came up and said, you know, you were good in this. We're doing another movie you might be right for. Who's your agent? I said, oh, I don't have an agent. I'm not an actor. I'm going to school. I said, well, no, come down and try out for it. And I did. And that was Dog Day Afternoon with Al Pacino. And it was a huge movie, and it really kicked me right off. I got an agent right out of it. I was working with my dad at the New York Film Festival, which he represented for 25 years, the first 25 years of its existence. And at the opening night, I'm standing there with my dad at Lincoln Center, and we're both in our tuxedos. And Bill Barnes, who was the head of ICM in New York, came up and said, I just saw a sneak of Dog Day. You were really good in that. Who's your agent? I said, oh, I don't have an agent. He said, well, we'd love to sign you. So I signed with them. And 3 weeks later, they got me a movie called Bernice Bobs Her Hair with Shelley Duvall and Bud Cort.
We want to show that clip, everybody, for Dog Day Afternoon. We have it. We have a clip of that.
My chicken clip?
Yes.
Yeah.
Russell, do you want to have him in the middle, or just take it all down and pull it all up?
Put it all up.
Okay, we're going to go and we're going to watch the clip as we take everybody below. Okay, guys? This is great.
Closing time. Want in?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I couldn't say.
You the manager?
It's a matter of policy. It looks...
Just keep talking like nothing was wrong.
Hey, listen, let me call you back.
I am getting really bad vibes.
What are you talking about?
Maybe we should take something smaller, Sonny.
You're crazy. Started already. He's got the gun out. Go ahead. Come over by the door. Get over by the door.
Get away from those alarms.
Cut!
Now get in the center. He moves. Take his head off. Put the gun on him. Get out of the center.
Sonny? I can't do it, Sonny.
What?
I'm not going to make it, Sonny.
What are you talking about? Put it on him.
I can't do it, Sonny.
Oh, fuck me. Sal. Sal. Yeah. What? Where are you? He can't make it.
Fuck him, let him go! Come on, Sonny!
All right, let him out. Let him out!
Do what the gentleman says, Howard.
Right, let him out. Let him out!
I'm sorry, Sonny.
Oh, shit. Stevie, don't take the car.
But how'll I get home?
Take the subway, we need the car. Stevie, the keys.
I'm sorry, Sonny.
How about I lock it? Oh, shit.
What do you want?
Hey, Sonny, there's a girl under that desk over there.
All right, come.
That was amazing. That was amazing. That was amazing.
It was a great, great experience. You know, for only my second film, and working with Pacino and John Cazale and Sidney Lumet, the director, it was really special. And yeah. one of the things that came out of it, which is that a lot of the crew, the same crew as Law and Disorder, and the New York crews all, you know, it's not like Hollywood where there's hundreds of, you know, they all pretty tight and everybody kind of works together. And I really love the way the you know, ADs controlled the set and the crews were bonded. They were real family. So actually I decided, again, I still wasn't that crazy about being an actor. So I went to a client of my father's who was about to start a new movie and said, look, I'd love to work on the movie as a PA or something. So I spent the next 6 months after we did Dog Day as a PA on Taxi Driver. So I was gonna try and get the into the Directors Guild program and all of that. And it was like the week after Taxi Driver finished, that was the New York Film Festival, and Bill Barnes came up and said, you know, you, and I told him I was going to do the other thing. He said, well, we can still send you out. You can still get jobs. And so I said, okay. So as I mentioned, within 2 weeks, they got me a job doing Bernice Bobs Her Hair with Shelley Duvall and Bud Cort. And we shot that in November of 74,
oh, wow.
November of 75, something like that. And Shelley came back to New York over Christmas, and she and her boyfriend and I were out for New Year's Eve, and they said, look, You said you didn't have to be back in school till February. Why don't you come out to California for a while? We'd love to have you come and stay with us.
Oh,
and I had never been there, and my agent wanted me to go out there anyway. So I went out and I stayed with Patrick and Shelley, I wound up spending 8 more years there. But I stayed with Patrick and Shelley, and it was a nice way to go to LA because Patrick was the heir to the R.J. Reynolds tobacco fortune. And they lived in a castle in the Hollywood Hills. And, you know, Shelley was a superstar at the time. You know, it was after Nashville and Three Women and all of these things. So, you know, and she knew everybody out there and they all loved Shelley. So it was really quite a nice way to go to California for the first time, meet my agents and start working. And I start working right away. I mean, a couple weeks after I was out there, Shelley had a party, and I was talking to a guy named Danny Selznick, whose father was David O. Selznick, and he was a producer director himself, and he put me in a movie of the week called Night Terror with Valerie Harper, and I just kept on working. That first year in L.A., just doing lots of television and episodics. I was in Happy Days. I was in MASH. Once in Eagle, which was another one of the long miniseries.
Mm-hmm.
And towards the end of the year, I was getting a little, you know, I had moved out. Shelley had moved back to New York. Patrick and Shelley broke up. She moved back to New York and moved in with Paul Simon. And I was living at a friend's house down in Venice, and getting a little disgruntled because it was like, LA wasn't my favorite place in the world. But my agent calls me up and says, I've got a Christmas present for you.
Yeah.
And it was the Hardy Boys. And so I got a TV series and I was Chet Morton in the Hardy Boys.
I was trying to find that.
Cassidy and Parker Stevenson. So that was pretty exciting. You know, that all of a sudden it made it all worthwhile. I actually had a parking space at the Universal Studios. But what happened is, you know, that started shooting in 77. Yeah, January of 77. And after the first couple of episodes, all they realized was that everybody just wanted the boys. You know, and they were being very religious about the stories. And in most of the stories, Chet, their best friend, would always get in trouble, and Frank and Joe would have to get him out of trouble. But we were getting less and less to do as the scripts were coming in. And one day I was at the commissary, and I ran into a man named John Hancock, who my dad had represented some of his movies, and I had met him. He did things like Bang the Drum Slowly and Let's Scare Jessica to Death. We were chatting and you know, he asked how I was doing, and I told him I'm doing the Hardy Boys. It's great. And he said, well, you know, I'm doing Jaws 2, and there's a great part in it, but I know that you're tied up with them. I went home, I called my agent, and I said, look, they don't want me. You know, they're writing us out of all the scripts because they just want to focus on the boys. So she called Universal and they said, sure. And so I left Hardy Boys and went right into Jaws 2. And that came about. It was really luck.
I met Sean Cassidy. He told me he got rid of you because you were taking you. Can you hear me now?
I can't hear you.
Uh-oh.
Oh, no.
How about now?
Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Yeah.
I can't hear either of you.
Jane, pull me down and Jane.
Hold on, let me
Jay,
take pull. It off. Let me take my ear off and put. How about that? Is that any better?
I can hear you.
I can hear you.
Can you hear us?
Can you hear us?
I still can't hear you guys.
Oh no.
Oh, no.
No.
I got the sound all the way up on just the regular computer.
Yeah, Are you on a regular? Can't hear us? Still not?
He can't hear us.
All right.
Can you pull him down and bring him back up?
Yeah, I'm gonna bring him back up again. Gary, just stay where you are, and I'm gonna bring you back on again. Sometimes we have technical difficulties. Sorry. Hold on. Michael, hold on. Oh man, he's coming. Can you just tell him to click on the link again?
Oh.
I had to pull him back down because the sound was not working. Anyways, guys, thanks for hanging on. We wanted to let him talk. We're going to get to your questions because we know you all. I've seen a bunch of like great questions. Yeah, RIP, John Cazale. I know. I wanted to ask him that too. We'll wait for him to come back on. Michael, if you could just contact him and let him know that I just...
I just messaged him.
Okay. And then I didn't want to interrupt him, but I wanted to go into the... too bad we didn't have any of those clips that he was talking about because I know he was in Taxi Driver, but I couldn't find anything. But we have that afternoon special we're going to surprise him with. So he's back here.
Is he back?
Yeah, he's back. And now we can't hear him.
Well, no, you will prompt.
Oh, there he is. There he is.
Yeah.
Hooray. Yes, we can hear you. Can you hear us?
Okay, good. Yeah, now I can hear you. Yeah.
Okay. Absolutely. Yeah. What I was saying is I met Sean Cassidy and he told me the reason they got rid of you is because you were pulling all the women away from Ian Parker Stevenson. So
okay. But it was great. I mean, those two were terrific guys. They were really good. And I'm still Facebook friends with Parker. I'm still in touch with Parker and writing back and forth. And, that doesn't happen that often in Hollywood. You know, you go off, you do a movie and you become best friends. And then the movie's finished or the show's finished. And then everybody goes their separate ways. With some projects, I mean, I've stayed friends with most of the people I've worked with. I'm still friends with Shelley Duvall and Bud Cort and Dennis Christopher, all from Bernice Bob's Her Hair. But what's really unusual is the Jaws 2 gang. We are all still best friends.
That is awesome.
And we all talk. Talk to Billy frequently. Gigi was just in New York. We had dinner last week. With Gigi. Kramer is still probably one of my best friends in the world. And that's unusual, that everybody stays together. I just became a grandfather. And Martha Swatek, Martha, of course, who gets eaten trying to save Sean, she said, I made these bibs when Cindy Grover became a grandmother. Let me make you some. So over the weekend, my 6-month-old grandson came down, and on Saturday, this package arrived with like 8 or 9 bibs that Martha handmade. So we all stay, and it's great because that usually doesn't happen. But look, we were in movie camp for 11 months. So you become bonded on that. I started that movie. I think I was cast in late February or early March of 77, something along those lines. Mm-hmm. And we didn't finish really until February of 78, January of 78. When we finally broke, we went back to LA and we were shooting scenes in Catalina in January. So it was almost an 11-month movie, which is pretty unusual.
Jay, do you have the one picture, either the one I sent you before the show or the one of...
John?
The one of Gary and Tegan West?
Yeah, I can get it. I just wanted to... Here's one with him and my...
Mark Gruner.
Yeah.
And Gary, I'll kind of comment on what you said. I've done a few book signings, none in New York yet, but when I've had the Jaws 2 kids together, and I've worked on some films, and I've seen how people kind of come and go, and you have that short friendship, and then you go your separate ways. And I was just amazed at how affectionate and how friendly everybody is, how everybody keeps in touch. And, even people that were in the film and then were replaced. Lenora May and I forgot her name now, but when I was out talking to to Billy Van Zandt. He was like, well, she did Agnes of God. Yeah.
Well,
that's going to kill me now.
Karen Corboy. And then Nancy, and I forget Nancy's last name, but Karen and Nancy Sawyer.
Nancy Sawyer. Yeah.
We're also Facebook friends to this day. You know, I mean, I wish them happy birthday. They wrote me when they saw pictures of my grandson, and you know, I mean, and that is pretty amazing how that all still goes on, and you keep that.
Okay, this is a shot from the Hancock era, as I call it. That's yourself. Tegan West is Mike Brody, and in the middle is Rick Schroeder as Sean Brody. Now, when we talked for the book, originally your character Andy had a much bigger and important role.
Yeah, Andy in the original Hancock script, which of course I loved, was the star. I mean, Andy, you know, I mean, this is one reason movies cost so much money and they're so dopey. I knew I was going to be gone for at least 6 months. So I had my best friend from New York, and his wife and son had just come out to California, and they got an apartment in I forget what it is, but it was Charlie Chaplin's old dressing room. It was a gorgeous place. Mm. On the old A&M, United Artists lot. But I was going away, so they moved into my house. I took my car and I was driving cross country, and I dropped a friend. I had a friend riding with me to Wisconsin, and got to Wisconsin, and I get a call from my agent saying, you've got to be back here tomorrow. And I said, there's no way I can be back. She said, well, they need you for makeup tests. And so I wound up the next day. I drove straight from Wisconsin to New York, got into New York, saw my grandparents, saw my mother. They all came out. We all met. My mother drove me into the city. I saw my girlfriend, and then went out to JFK and flew back to LA. And the next morning I was on the Universal lot, and they were doing braces. Andy had fake braces. I was really a dork. I mean, look at that picture. I'm wearing this goofy, you know, Robin Hood hat with a feather and fake braces.
I like it. I think it's adorable. I liked you. I thought you were the best. Look at everybody here. But you're my favorite character besides Marge.
And then they also said, oh, well, we could have done this down in Florida. You didn't need to come back. They just told me, you know, they said you were available. So that's why movies cost so much. But anyway, that's digressing. But the braces, you know, were really, Andy was a wimp. But when the shark comes, he's the only one who had any sense. Everybody was screaming and panicking, except for the loser Andy, who doesn't get the girl, who everybody makes fun of. And it's like, over there, throw that over there, tie that. You know, and a lot of that came through into the second one, but it was much more democratic in the final version. But I even saved the helicopter pilot in that script. I wind up diving after the helicopter is overturned. I dive in and swim to the helicopter and rescue him. Roy was not very happy with that. Roy was not very happy with Andy being such a hero.
Wait a minute, Gary, you're on a roll and you've got great stories, but we have people bombarding us, like wanting to ask you questions. And one of them is, he's a friend from Brazil. He wanted to know, he says, tell us about Camp Universal on the Jaws 2 set, Gary. What kind of physical training did you guys go through? It must have been pretty intense, not just for sailing, but for pulling each other out of the water over and over again. How was that?
Well, we did training. I mean, when we first, in late April, early May, when with Jaws 1, Jaws 2, Part 1, we went down to Florida, and for the first 2 weeks, we had nothing to do with the movie at all. We were in sailing school because we had to look like we've been sailing all our lives.
Yeah,
and
that's a great question.
We started off in a schoolroom with Ellen, If you remember the bartender from the Hog's Breath,
that Ellen Demme.
Ellen Demme was a U.S. Navy sailing instructor, and she was our sailing instructor. But we spent like the first 2 weeks just on mock-ups and on books and learning the wind before we even got out into the water. And then they put us on Sunfish. And so we were just sailing around in the intercoastal down in Fort Walton on Sunfish. And then we went right to the boats we were sailing in the movie. And the boat that I was on with Mike was a Tornado, which was what the U.S. Olympic racing team raced. And it was so fast and it was so light. And that was one of the problems, is that it was so light that if you just touch the hull, it would crack because they were these fiberglass. So we would be coming in, and even if we were sailing well, we would just scrape, like, you know, when we should have turned a little bit faster, and it scrapes it and said, okay, well, that hull's gone. That's another $4,000. So, but you know what you did wrong? Yeah, sure. But we really became very proficient at sailing, and I loved it.
In the movie, it's so.
Ray Lloyd, who wrote the Jaws 2 log from down there, wrote about how Springer, probably the best sailor of the group, but I loved it. I would go out every day, whether we had to or not, and sail, just because it was so much fun.
Oh, that's awesome. Rogerio was putting this on four times already. He's like, I know. He's like, okay, Mr. Springer, it's a pleasure to talk to you. My question is about the cast of teenagers in the version of the John Hancock to the version that, I'm sorry, Mike, I can't read it now. The first cast of teenagers in the version of John Hancock to the version that went to cinema screens. And could you tell us about the darker view than Mr. Hancock had for the film? So basically wants to know the difference between how Mr. Hancock.
I honestly don't remember. Because somebody else had asked me that just the other day. I was talking to somebody about it, and they said, you know, I understand it was a much darker version. And I don't remember that, that it was a much darker version. The kids were definitely more prominent than they were. And that, you know, again, that was one of the things that I think, you know, was upsetting Roy, that the kids were definitely more prominent. I don't necessarily remember to be that dark, but I haven't read that script in 20 years. So I'm sorry. I should get up on that, but I'm not. But, the version, I mean, John, and I still work with John as a publicist. I have represented, I've represented his last few films.
Yeah.
That he's done. He lives in Indiana now. Indiana. He's making films out of Indiana. And, you know, I get along fine with John and Dorothy. But I just kind of think that what was happened was that he was really over his head. I think that the script again was a lot different. And I know Roy was very unhappy. You know, we were having a lot of problems with the shark up on the vineyard, which was great because every time there was a problem, they would just tell us to go off and go sailing. Go sail. You know, so it really was summer camp. We wound up doing a scene, I think it was scene K5 for some reason, K5, 6 in my head, where we were on the dock up in Martha's Vineyard. And whenever the shark wasn't working, we would go and shoot K5. Now, we shot that scene multiple times. And I think that's another reason was like John just, you know, I think he was a little over his head with that one. And also there was, you know, there was a whole thing with Tegan and Nancy and Karen and I, where Dorothy was, we were working out the kind of romance scene down at the beach. And Dorothy and the girls got very upset because she was saying, okay, well now feel her there, put your arm on her thigh and kiss her there. And I think that they complained about that too. Although Dorothy was great, you know, she did it fine. But I think there was just a couple of those, a number of these elements that came together, which is why, you know, the change was made. But I, as I said, loved John's. Well, I like this guy here. Andy's character seemed to show a bit more depth than many of the other
characters.
Yeah, that's true because it was held over from the first script that Andy's character did have a little more going on for him. A lot of the teens, you know, in the second version with their new people, we were just kind of window dressing, you know, let's throw them out there and let them get eaten.
Jay, do you have the picture I sent right before the show?
I have one with Roy in him. Would you like that one?
Well, no, the one with the four of them that I sent right before the show. I messaged it with Tegan and Gary and Martha and Sarah Holcomb.
I believe I do. Just give me one second. Here we go. I got it right here. Let me get rid of this. Hold on. Yeah.
I love Sarah Holcomb.
Hold on. Let me pull it up. What was that? Let's see. Gary, I'm going to read that one while I pull up the clip there, Gary. Let's see. Here we go.
Well, we're waiting. Jamie wants to know, it's your friend Jamie from Canada. Thanks for the autographed pictures. You are Jawsome. Who are you closest with in the Jaws 2 class?
Well,
maybe not now, but not now, but shooting.
Yeah. Gigi and John Dukakis and Jeffrey Kramer, and Dusenberry, we were all very close. We would all just plop into everybody else's rooms and we would go out for dinners. We were it was a pretty tight-knit group, but probably, you know, Jeffrey and Gigi and Dukakis and were when we were shooting probably my closest down there. And Dusenberry.
Okay, this is a picture.
I love this picture of my bare chest there.
I love it.
This is a picture that's in our Jaws 2 book. Left to right, that's Tegan West, Sarah Holcomb, Martha Swatek, Marge, and then Gary. You mentioned that you love Sarah Holcomb. She was the only actress that I could not get a hold of. She had a rough time in Hollywood. I was able to talk to her brother and through her family, and I sent her a copy of the book, and they sent a very nice note back to me thanking me for the way I kind of handled her as far as not being in the book. Do you have a fun memory of her?
I have a real fun memory of her. She was a really, really sweet girl. And she was my next door neighbor at the Holodome, which was also strange living, you know, all that time in a Holiday Inn. But yeah, Sarah, she just never, it never really was clicking for her. I mean, she went off and had a very nice career, you know, brief, but you know, I mean, things like, Caddyshack and Animal House and, you know, some very, very good roles. But yes, she had a hard time in Hollywood and wound up leaving and moving back east where she grew up.
Well, her brother told me that she ended up dating Hunter S. Thompson for 6 months. And I was like, well, that explains so much.
That explains a lot. Actually, yeah. I think I knew that, but my sister actually went to school with a girl whose sister also lived with Hunter S. Thompson for a couple of years. So,
well, Jay, let's try to bring up some questions here before we
wrap up. By the way, going back to the other picture that you had of me yelling at Sean.
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't know where it came from, but somebody sent me a that picture. It was a meme. It was like, you know, me going like this yelling, and it's like that guy at Walmart who sees you 6 feet, you know, without a mask or something like that.
You're still famous.
I'm still famous. I love that. I thought that was really fun.
That's awesome. You are a mean, Gary. You're a mean. That's awesome. I mean, come on.
Yeah. Let's see. Nate Jones wants to know, despite the friction with Scheider over the film and director, how was he personally?
Honestly, when we were shooting, we had nothing to do with Roy. He had nothing to do with us. You know, I mean, we did what we had to do, but he really didn't want to be there. And there was lots of friction with Roy and Jeannot, to the one point where they literally had a fist fight. And everybody was outside of the room. Verna Fields, who was a big woman, and David Brown, who was, you know, in his, you know, an elder gentleman, very gentleman, were, you know, they were pulling Roy off Jeannot, and Jeannot, they were holding each other back, and Roy and Jeannot were going at it, and we were all in the parking lot listening and watching this thing going on. But wow. I later, because, you know, I moved back to New York in 82, got married and decided that, you know, I had enough of Hollywood. Roy and I became quite friendly because I would see him at a lot of events. I represented the Museum of the Moving Image. I represented the Hamptons Film Festival, and he lived out in the Hamptons. And we actually became quite friendly. But during the shoot, it was not.
Yeah. Some of the... great story that Brian Upman, who was cast there for a while, told me that when he got fired, he was flying home on the same plane and Roy was on it. And Roy came and sat down next to him during the flight, gave him a card. If you ever need anything, he said he was really, really compassionate over the fact that he had lost his job. But on the other hand, Jeff Kramer told me that they had to put cones around Roy's Mercedes. So the crew said, so the crew wouldn't piss on it. So,
well, you know, the last day of filming, we were supposed to wrap at like 3 o'clock, and between every take, and this has been going on for a while, between every take, Roy would undress.
Oh,
he
God.
Would take his and sit there with his sun visor on the back of the boat. We were on this huge boat about a mile or so out into the Gulf.
Yeah.
And 3 o'clock came and Roy said, okay, I'm finished. And we weren't finished yet. We still had a little more to do. And he refused to do it. And so David Brown, who was, you know, they were going back and forth on the phone. David was back at the Holodome. He wound up having to take a boat out and he threatened Roy quite, you know, I mean, and as I mentioned, David was a gentleman, you know, yelling at Roy, saying that he, you know, this was it. He was done. So Roy finished it. It was only like two more setups, but it also took forever because between every setup, he would take his shirt off and sit there with his sun visor and just to bust balls.
Oh man, are you serious? Oh, good Lord, that's a great story though. Oh my
God. Trying to see some other questions here.
Yeah, there's a picture of you. There you go. It's a close up.
Yeah.
You and Rick, you know, and no, that's Mark Gilpin. That's yeah.
Yeah, that's Mark Gilpin
and Ben Marley.
I had never studied acting. As I had mentioned, I just was at cocktail parties, and after Jaws, my sister was studying with Lee Strasberg in New York.
Lee Strasberg
was doing 6 months in New York, 6 months in LA. And Lee was, you know, one of the toughest acting coaches around. And, you know, because my sister was living with them, with Anna and Lee and their two sons, in the house that Laurence Olivier had built for Vivian Lee. Beautiful house in Brentwood. And they were like, why aren't you studying? Why aren't you taking classes? And I'm like, I play me. But anyway, I did start studying with them. And that moment where I'm hugging Sean, Lee had come up to me afterwards and he said, it was the only real part of the whole movie. He said, you were very good there. It was the only honest part in the whole movie.
Praise.
I took a high, you know, high praise from Lee
High
Strasberg.
Praise indeed.
Exactly.
High
praise indeed. Yeah, hello.
Wow.
I'd have to say he was correct.
Let's see. Michael Roddy's here. Hey, Mike. Wants to know, what was the experience of finally seeing the film in the summer of 78, and how was it seen with an audience?
Oh, it was great. I we all went together. It was like, you know, and we were all, you know, as again, we were buds. We, you know, and we made it like a camp trip to go see the movie, not organized by Universal or anything. And it was, you know, I mean, we had seen it originally at screenings and stuff like that, you know, cast and crew screening and things like that. But I think it was all of us. I think it was John and Gigi and Kramer and Annie and Ben. I think we all went and saw the movie together. And that was pretty exciting to see it with, you know, and hearing the screams and hearing the squeak, you know, the shrieks. And, you know, there would have been a lot more shrieks if more people got killed, which they, you know, they should have, you know, because that's another reason the movie took so long. Because, you know, Billy was supposed to get killed. Martha was supposed to be a bloody death. And so we had to film these things where, you know, there was blood, lots of blood. Then we had to film it again with no blood. And then we had to film it again, like in Billy's case, you know, at the end when everybody is up on Cable Junction, you know, with Billy, without Billy. You know, so that, you know, it's, but then they wound up taking almost all the blood out. No blood for Gary Dubin, no blood for Martha Swatek.
Yeah.
You know, Billy didn't get chomped in half. He lived.
I was looking, I had a look at my book. The actress I was thinking of was Lily Knight.
Lily Knight, yes, yes, exactly.
She did Agnes God on Broadway. Okay.
Again, Lenora May, and we stayed friendly. I mean, you know, with Lenora, we would see each other afterwards in Hollywood and back and forth. But Luke asked, what did you think of the shark in Jaws 2? And it was like, I thought the shark was great. The only time I was ever scared, was when the shark burst up, when we're stuck just going to Cable Junction, and the shark burst up through the bottom of the catamaran and we all go in the water. Well, you go in the water there and you see that big eye and those teeth when you're underwater. But not only that, it was all the cables that made the shark work and all the cables from the boats. It was, you know, that was pretty scary. swimming through there. But yeah, that was the only time the shark really kind of affected me. But we actually had regular sharks. I mean, because as I said, we were, you know, in the catamaran.
Yeah.
And we were sailing. There's a trench off of Navarre Beach, off of the peninsula there. And it's a home for hammerheads. And those things are ugly. And so we would be sailing along, and all of a sudden there's a hammerhead right between our two pontoons, you know, keeping pace with us. And we were going pretty fast. And, you know,
that's scary. I'd be so scared. Oh my God.
15 minutes later, we're jumping in the water where all these sharks were.
Hell no. Hell no.
Jane Clark wants to know, what's your favorite scene from the movie?
Oh, I think saving Sean. Because first of all, it was Lee Strasberg's favorite scene.
but it
was also fun to do because, you know, there was so much going on there with the shark attacking and Martha getting eaten and then Sean and us trying to throw the ropes and it was entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
But nice. I think that was probably my favorite scene.
Good. Well, before we wrap up, I want to bring up, for those of you who don't know, Gary's son, Nick, is a Paralympic gold medal winner in rugby. Is it rugby?
Wheelchair rugby.
Wheelchair rugby?
If you ever saw the movie Murder Ball, Murder Ball was about the U.S. wheelchair rugby team. in Athens, 2004. And my son Nick made the team right after that in 2005. He had lost his arms and legs to meningitis when he was 14 years old in 1999. And he never stopped. Before he was even out of rehab, we were sneaking him out because he was a hockey player prior to that. He didn't play any other sports. He didn't play football. He didn't play soccer or baseball. He played hockey, roller hockey, ice hockey all year long. So we were sneaking him out of rehab, putting sweat socks over his stumps and duct taping the sticks. And he was doing sled hockey. And, you know, he was quite good at it, except, you know, he didn't have a great shot because he didn't have an arm, but he was like, he would go up and he could punch that puck really well. And he knew the game. But after a couple of years of doing that, his coach and one of the teammates, Victor Calisi, who was on the U.S. sled hockey team at Nagano, said, you know, Nick, there's this other sport that you might like. And he goes, nope, I just want to do this one. I just want to really get good at this. This is, you know, so try it. So for like 3 or 4 weeks, we couldn't get him to go to a practice. And we finally got him to go to a practice. And he watched for a little while. And then he rolled off the court with this grin on his face. And he goes, Dad, you know, I think I could be really good at this. And within a year, he was on the U.S. Developmental team. Wow. And then wound up, he was the MVP. There he is with his gold medal and his gold medal from Beijing and bronze medal from London. He was the MVP of the gold medal game in Beijing.
I tell you, if those of you watching, just search for Nick Springer online. It's an inspirational story. I've told you before, we've messaged Gary. I consider Nick a personal hero because yeah. what he has persevered through and to not let a lot of people would have had that illness and they would have just given up and he never did.
Never did. And as I said, from sneaking him out while he was still in rehab to play hockey, he was never depressed. He'd get frustrated, you know, he couldn't do things at first, but he never got, you know, depressed or, oh, my life is over. And you know, he says that sports saved his life.
Wow. Great.
But he was here. He left this morning. He came for Labor Day because he hadn't seen the grandchild yet because Olivia, my daughter, didn't want him to just fly in and, you know, see the baby. So he had to drive 2 weeks ago and he drove and he quarantined and got a COVID test. And so they all came down for Labor Day. So we all got to spend the weekend together. And he just drove out this morning. He just left this morning. Driving his own car, you know. That's awesome. And he doesn't use prosthetics because they make him bleed and they cut his arms because his skin is so fragile. So, you know, he drove by himself across country. He lives in Phoenix. And
I'm from Phoenix. Oh, really? Where? Where does he live?
He lives right near Tempe.
Scottsdale?
Papago Park.
I know exactly where that is. I know exactly.
Yeah, he lives on Washington Street, which when it crosses the river into Tempe becomes Mill Street, which is the big one with all the bars and restaurants. Yeah.
Yes, it's gorgeous there. It's gorgeous there. Beautiful.
Well, Gary, go ahead.
We didn't, you know, all the fans are still here, and I'm sorry, but I know we didn't get a chance to really show some of the clip because you know, the Jaws too. I mean,
that's true.
And we just want to say, Gary, like, I swear, I haven't met anybody else that, like, it's always Gary and Marge. That's the only it's like our favorites, right?
Marge and I, in theory, and this is something that actually Martha and I talked about a couple of weeks ago. She said, we were kind of dating, weren't we? And I said, well, yeah, a little bit, you know what, because we went, you know, in, we didn't, it was never written, there was anything, but, you know, we both did the scuba diving thing together. Yeah. And when we came off the boat, we were holding hands. I was holding her hand when we came off the boat. And said, yeah, you know, it, in theory, Andy and Marge could be dating. Yeah.
Oh well, okay, guys, don't go anywhere. Check it out. We want to show the clip here.
Mr. Quiston, pump up this belt. Shave off that dreadful mustache. England expects every man to do his duty. You may fire when ready, Gridley. Damn the torpedoes. Full speed ahead. This will be our finest hour.
Oh, shit.
Hey, Bly, someone pop your balloon?
No problem.
That was a great scene to shoot too. I mean, that was a lot of fun.
It looked terrifying.
Yeah, no, that was definitely a lot of fun to do.
Wow.
Gary, are you angered? Oh, Victor wants to know: are you angered by all the bashing Donna Wilkes gets about Jackie constantly screaming?
It was a little obnoxious when you were shooting it, but I'm not angry about it because it's kind of right. But it was the poor editor, Neil Travis, who had to cut that whole end of the movie. She's screaming. So he's sitting there in a small editing room with the speakers, just listening to her scream for weeks.
And for those of you who aren't aware, the reason that she is screaming so much is she is witnessing Billy Van Zandt. She is witnessing Bob being killed. Yeah. So she's not just screaming because, you know, somebody fell in the water, somebody being eaten. So, well, Jay, can you bring up next week's guest photo, and we'll say our goodbye to Gary and thank him for his time.
Gary, thank you so much.
This was great. I really enjoyed speaking with both you guys.
Man, we love your stories. You had me laughing so hard. Mike, I swear to God, your stories were awesome. Really awesome. I applaud you. I mean, it was great. I'm sure you have
I got a million of them.
Questions about Meryl Streep and, you know, the poor RIP to John Cazale, you know, like they wanted to know about that. But I mean, we only have so much time, but man, it's been such a pleasure having you on the show. It really has.
My pleasure as well.
Perfect.
We didn't get enough, Michael. I know we're next week. We have a surprise guest next week. Your buddy, Gary. John Hancock is joining us next week, actually.
Oh, good.
Yes. And Gary, we were going to pull your after school special and we had gotten over and talked.
Dinky Hawker. I watched it again today.
I loved it. I love it because I'm like, oh my God, I recognize some of the other girl that was in that.
It was Wendy Jo Sperber.
Yes.
It was Wendy Jo Sperber and John Walmsley from the Waltons and June Lockhart.
From the Waltons.
And I had a quick question. In the credits at the end, it says Robin Williams. Is that the same Robin Williams?
No.
Okay. In the credit, it had additional cast members, but I watched it twice today and I didn't see him.
You know what he might have done? I did after Jaws, one of the things that happened, which kept my career going so well, was Allison Kane, who was Carl Gottlieb's wife. Carl Gottlieb, of course, wrote the movie. She really started before Jaws. If they needed crowd walla, they would usually just have it in a library someplace that they would pull it out of a sound library. But Allison, because Carl was a member of the committee, and he used to live with Howard Hessman and, you know, all the Saturday Night Live people with all their best friends. So Allison had put together this loop group, which was probably the original loop group. Now they're all over the place. Now there's hundreds of loop groups. But this was really one of the first ones. I wound up doing almost 45 movies. And in some, it would just say loop group, you know, by Allison Kane or something like that. In others, we would get credit. The loop group would get credit, so maybe there was a loop group on it that Robin did.
Oh, okay, that would make sense.
Oh, Mike, Matt wants Matt. I know we should, right, Matt? We want to have Gary come on again and tell more stories. Gary, Matt says we need to get Gary back on. Great stories. I'd love to hit a barbecue with play a little cornhole, not fast.
Definitely. We'll definitely have him back. If he has the time, we'll definitely have him. Gary, thank you so much.
Thank you, Gary.
Thank you guys very much.
Awesome. Have a good night, Gary. Thank you.
Good night, Jay. Good night, Mike.
Good night, everybody.
Talk to you soon.
Michael, we just wanted to show, I put in, Michael wanted me to put the picture up, but look, we have none other than John Hancock joining us next Thursday. Can you believe it?
Victor? So all the questions you have about the dark version of Jaws 2, that's the man to ask.
Yes, it is. I'm sitting here like trying to pull up. I want to make sure that I wanted to pull that dinky
Hawker up. It's on YouTube. 36 minutes. It's funny.
Gary, if you're watching this again, really, you have to come on. You were awesome. It was so much fun to see you on there. We really, really enjoyed it. Let's see. How do we put him in the middle? Is he in the middle yet?
No, he's on the. That's fine. There we go.
There's him with Rim Roy, John. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Victor. Okay. Oh, Gary left already, but we can ask him again. Gary, if you're rewatching this, answer any plans, Gary, to write a book on your own great career? That's a great question. We should have asked him earlier. Who is that? I don't see the name.
Oh, Facebook user.
Jeffrey Kramer did Loop Sound and Jaws 3D. Hi, Luke.
Hi, Luke.
I'm sorry about the name thing. Sometimes you have to go in there.
Yeah, that's not coming up on my iPad. Who's asking that?
Is that John? John Conradi? Okay. John Hancock made the best baseball movie, Bang the Drum Slowly. Wow. Victor knows that. Yep. He's going to ask him questions about that.
Yeah. It's going to be a good night. We got a good lineup. And then the week after that, we have Billy Van Zandt.
Yep.
And we're lining up more.
We're just on fire, Michael. I'm telling you, we're having a good time, man. I'm telling you, it's the best.
We were the first Jaws podcast. Yeah. Except no duplicates. Except no substitutes.
So. Thanks, Jane. Thank you, Donna. Thank you, Victor. Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Luke. I'm thinking, John. Good night, John boy. Thank you, Rogerio. Thank you, Luke Cheeseman. I seen you. I was trying to get everybody on, but he was talking, and I wanted him to tell the story. Thank you guys so much. This was a fun episode, as always, Michael.
Always a good time.
All right. Well, we're going to leave you guys. Leave questions if you're joining. If you didn't make the – did Keith – was Keith Stevenson on here tonight? I think he was. Somebody said hi. Hi, Keith. If I didn't see you, I don't know if – I didn't see your name, but I wanted to make sure I said hi to you, too. And if John Conradi's on, I wanted to say hi, too. I don't know. I couldn't see his Facebook username.
Yeah.
If you are joining us and you want to come on again live, make sure you go to the Jaws Live Facebook and there'll be a little link that you click on that will show your name on the screen. So we'd love to see your name there so we know. I see somebody's little emoji. It's got to be John, right? It's got to be John. I think it is. I don't know. If it's not, I don't know. Anyways, okay, well, we're going to leave them tonight. Have a good night, guys. We'll see you next Thursday with John.
John Hancock. You can tell us all about... You can tell us all about signing the Declaration of Independence.
It's going to be awesome. You got to come back. And don't forget to, like, Michael, we're up to, like, almost 500, 430 people. But you know what doesn't matter about the size? Oh, God, here I go, man. I love it. Right open again.
I've been saying that for 40 years. Yeah.
There's been a bunch of people that didn't know about it, and I sent them a couple of links. I'm like, I sent them the invite, and they were like, oh, thanks, and like, they didn't know about it. So I keep forgetting, like, I gotta go through the list and, you know, invite people. Thank you, Victor. Thank you, guys. It was interesting. You gotta come back. I mean, we had a great guest. All right, that's it. We'll wrap it up.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody. Good night, everybody.